Have you ever tried to film something with one hand? Imagine trying to cut something when your camera is in the other hand. Sure, you could ask somebody to hold the camera for a minute or set up some tripod that's so far away from the table you can't see what you're doing. Building something with one hand on a camera is tough. What you need is something to put your camera on so you can use both hands. When you're constantly picking up your camera and hand holding a shot, and then you need to do something on the table, it gets really cumbersome with a tripod. I made this little jig that you can hold your camera while you're working. You can see what you're doing, you can see what you're filming, and it's not in the way. For something like this, you can't just go down to Walmart and pick one up. They don't exist. So I had a bunch of junk laying around, so I decided to make something to hold my camera. Well, you can see I'm still hitting this thing with one hand. It's very cumbersome. I can't wait till I have this thing built so I don't have to just use one hand. Now this dowel rod is a little bit loose. So whenever this happens, you wrap tape around it, right? Usually, when you wrap tape around something, you typically have two hands, but I'll do it one-handed a little longer. I tore that tape pretty good with one hand. Now it's fitting a lot tighter. That's what I'm talking about. Now, how do I get this thing to stop so it doesn't fall out the other end? I'll grab that box of zip ties. There's gotta be something in here somewhere. This'll work just the right size. Now, if I could just do it one-handed. Yeah, you caught me. I turned off the camera and I zipped it up with two hands. Now let's just simply cut off the zip tie. Great. Now it stops and it won't go all the way through. I gotta say, this weight is pretty handy, but it's not very stable. I need something with a lip on it, maybe a bowl. I'm gonna go into the kitchen, dig around. This yogurt container looks just the right size. This'll give it a nice edge so it doesn't rock all over the table. Now, all I need is a hole dead center so I can put the rod all the way through. Like normal, I cannot find my center punch. Well, I'll just make one. Hardened steel nails are absolutely wonderful. Masonry nails never bend. Let's cool it off and see what we got. This is better than my center punch anyway. So I need to make a little mark right in the middle so I can start to drill this hole. Don't want the hole to be off center. Ugh, a little crack. Whatever, it's not gonna be that big of a deal. If you've never used a step drill to do prototyping, you are missing out. Oh, the crack got a little bigger. Oh well, I'm sure if I was able to use two hands, I wouldn't have cracked it. As the drill bit goes deeper and deeper, the hole gets bigger and in a precise way. Well, it looks like it's about the right size. Now, I need a ream. Oh good, right where I left it. This thing keeps moving around, but it's working. Just the right size. Let's go ahead and glide it all the way down. That weight will just fit right inside, nice and neat. Oh yeah, look at how stable that is. As cool as it is, the weight keeps dropping down, of course. And the stick, it moves up and down. We gotta somehow secure all this. My glue bin, it's a mess, but I found the glue gun. I'm just gonna start dumping hot glue in here until that weight stops moving. Okay, I need to let the hot glue warm up a little bit more. Always trying to push it. I can find little glue sticks, but I can't find my big glue sticks. Well, at least I've got a small hot glue gun. If I put enough hot glue in here, this weight will stop. Nice, that's what I call some progress. Now it sits on the table and it's stable. Now that I've got the base made, I need something that'll hold the camera. I want something like an offset cam, so as it drops down, it locks into place. I want it nice and simple so I don't have to twist any knobs just to move the camera. So now it'll go up, it'll go down, side to side. I really like this big sander. It is really easy to work with. Well, I sure hope I don't flip this piece of wood into the air because I'm doing it one-handed. I think I'll round the edges of these corners because rounded corners look better, right? I don't want just some prototype. I want something to look cool. Okay, so this longer piece is going to be what the camera rests on. It's kind of a germ of an idea, but I think it might work. I'm going to need some sort of a stop to stop the camera from sliding. I think that'll give me a nice angle. I'll put another one on so I can get a steeper angle. Depending upon how steep of an angle I need, I'll have two options. Now I need some glue. Hot glue is not going to cut it. Let's pull out this mess of epoxy. Nothing works better than epoxy, but it is a mess. Let's just dip this in like a potato chip and glue it together. Let's put a little extra glue just to make sure it's strong because I don't want my camera falling. I'll shove a piece of wood in there to really give it some strength. I'll put on a couple more strips of wood for the angle locks. Yeah, angle locks. It sounds like a good name. They lock in the angle of the camera. Angle locks. I need a round dowel rod so I can place it at the top so the camera doesn't fall off. Well, if you couldn't tell, I cut that one-handed. When I set the camera in, I can see that this back angle lock is too short. The front one's looking pretty good, but I need to raise the second angle lock. You see what this looks like when I put it down the shaft here and spin it around. This offset cam is looking really nice, pretty effective. Let's set the camera in there and see how it fits. The first angle looks good, but the second angle is not working that well. Let's try a bigger piece of wood to see if we can get the angle a little greater. As you can imagine, that piece flew all the way across the room. This angle is definitely working better. I'm getting a little glue on the phone, but that's the sacrifice, isn't it? Just to straighten it up a little bit, I'll go ahead and sand off a little bit. We certainly don't want our jig looking ugly, do we? Of course, the glue is a little soft, but that's what we do. We push drying times here. So the thought is, I can set my phone down into the jig, take the picture, and if I need to pick it up and do another shot, no problem. Just grab it and go. Typically, I need two angles, one really steep and one a little more straight. The offset cam allows me to raise and lower it really easy, and then it just locks. I'm also really liking how small it is and how it sits right on the table between your arms. I am so glad it's not in the way. It's just like a helping hand. Now, a lot of people will come in and say, wow, that thing is cool, but it is ugly. Whatever, I'll just give it a coat of paint to satisfy those folks. This butter tub is high density polyethylene, so when you paint it, you have to be really light with the coat. If you go too heavy, it's gonna crack off. But this coat of paint is just purely aesthetics. When you're building prototypes, it's more important that it's functional so you can get the feel of it. You can always work on how it looks later. Of course, when you're making it, you also have to think, how would I mass produce this if it goes into production? Does this product really need a name? Well, I keep calling it the jig, so I'll make a label for it. I could type it up in the computer, make it all nice, print it out, but computers, nope. Now, computers do play a very important role in new product development, but sometimes you just need to be hands-on. You cannot rely on computers to make something work. It's just another tool. Now, if this works well, the next rev, we may need to use a CNC mill, 3D printer, laser cutter, all these things. But at this stage, it's better that it's rough because you're not afraid to cut it and break it and improve it. If your prototype is too pretty, you may not want to mess with it. You may not want to break it. You want to make sure these things are rough and you feel like you can make changes when it doesn't work right. I've been building prototypes for new product development for over 30 years. You want to embrace technology, but you don't want to cut out the thinking part of it. You want your first prototypes to be ugly because then you're not afraid to change it because they always need to be changed and they're never going to be perfect, and that's okay. So I'm pretty excited about the new jig. It's revision one, but as I use it, I'll think of improvements. I'm already thinking of a flashlight right down below it to give me a little more light. But see, that's the advantage of rough prototyping. I hope this video gives you the confidence to think outside the box. Now, go out and invent something cool. I appreciate your time and thanks for watching.